no. I don't think so. Not on our watch. Owen Smith is basing his campaign on being a man of principle. And because as a Labour man, well, I don't doubt that he has some principle. But I have to say to him this, and I have to say it loud and clear. Owen, you have just engaged in a process that has undermined the very fabric of what this party has built upon. We, as Labour members, place our trust in you as an MP to defend a process that gives every Labour member a democratic right to elect a leader who they believe can fight the Tory government and a leader who they believe can bring our party back to power and become the next Prime Minister of this country. Women died for my right to engage in this process, and I for one will not be letting them women down by giving in to the dark forces that have plotted and campaigned to make Jeremy Corbyn's time as leader the most fragmented, undemocratic and unconvicted time in this party's history. Never has a leader of Her Majesty's opposition had to endure such an uphill struggle. 83% of the media, that's 83%, are uninformative of Jeremy Corbyn's views or totally biased against him. This is a man who won the last leadership election with an overwhelming majority. A man who, as leader, overtook the Tories in local government elections. A man who, as leader, won four parliamentary by-elections and increased majorities in three of them, recruited over 300 new members, scored a win on working tax credits, personal independence payments and a retreat on forced academisation of schools. Can you imagine just how good he would be if he had the Labour machine working for him?
I don't even agree with that one. Question to Gordon, we'll say that a few times. Fantastic. Listen, we have some comrades who are struggling because we need someone to sign. Is there anyone who can sign for them? If they are, please make their way around to the stewards and come forward, and we'll put their hand up if there's anyone who can sign, and we'll try and bring them forward to support our comrades down here. Just to let you know, we've got the leader of Knowsley Council, Councillor Andy Moorhead, who has endorsed Jeremy Corbyn today. I said last week, if Owen Smith's the answer, I haven't got a clue what the question is. I'm constantly baffled because I get people like Neil Kinnock. Neil Kinnock! Not one-time loser, but a two-time once when he snatched the jaws of victory. Ed Miliband, loser. Gordon Brown, loser. And they have the cheek, the temerity, to look down on us and say we don't understand. I think we understand very, very well. I think what we need to do is actually unite and follow what we're all here for. I'm going to bring up the next speaker, who is he's a fantastic young momentum campaigner, and Rhea Scranton for the NSC.
Here in this campaign, and it's the most fantastic city, and I'm so excited. I've never been in a fire engine before, and this is really quite amazing. My name is Jane Wilson, I'm running for Labour's National Executive Committee. Labour's National Executive Committee, for those who don't know, is a slightly less glamorous role than Labour leader. It's the body that makes decisions about the running of the Labour Party. You might have heard of them recently, that the body that decides how our leadership races are run, either run fairly or not so fairly. I'm also, in my free time, I'm a GMP branch secretary in Glasgow. And it's the thing that gives me the experience to talk about why Jeremy Corbyn is the way forward for the Britain. People talk about what Jeremy stands for, and they use anti-austerity like it's a buzzword. It's not a buzzword. Being anti-austerity is about fundamentally changing how society treats those who suffer most when we prioritise bankers over workers. I see every day in my role, my union, what austerity means for people. Austerity means having to work a 50-hour week over split shifts, spending 12 hours a day at work at 60 so that you can support your grandchildren because their parents can't. It is about leaving your husband at home with MS for 12 hours a day because you can't access care and you can't get the leniency from your employer to get him and feed him at lunchtime because of the pressure that is on that local authority. Austerity wrecks lives and it is destroying people in the UK, and to compromise on austerity in any way is unacceptable for any Labour Party. And so I am proudly supporting Jeremy Corbyn, who I know will not change my members for anyone in the UK. The general election in 2020 under Jeremy Corbyn. I hope you do. is fundamental in changing society, but it is the tip of the iceberg. We can do so much more as a community that we are building. This country needs us. It needs this movement. It needs us to be in every single part of society, from our parliament down to our councils, down to our community centres. That is how we affect change. Just like in the Labour Party, we must change the structures at every single level, from leader down to branch. We will have not only Labour leader, but the NEC, we have branch secretaries, CLP secretaries, and we will ensure that this party becomes the democratic, transparent and representative party that we deserve. That I don't think reflect our values. It has priced people out of democracy. It has frozen out hundreds of thousands of new members who joined our party to be part of something. And I cannot understand the decision that someone would take to exclude people from a mass movement, because we are trying to build a mass movement behind an amazing leader and an amazing parliamentary Labour Party that we will elect. We are the Labour Party, and we must elect those that represent our values. That's Jeremy Corbyn, but I have to put a plug in for what we're doing as well. The NEC election closes this Friday at midday. Please ensure that you cast your vote. If you join the Labour Party before June 24th, you are eligible to vote in the National Executive Committee election. And there's six of us who are supporting Jeremy, and supporting not only Jeremy, but the principles that he stands for, and just fundamentally democracy within the Labour Party. I will never, on the National Executive Committee, shut down CLP meetings. We need more spaces for debate and democracy. Of course our party is struggling, we're not allowed to talk to each other. We can only thrive as a party when we create spaces for open and frank and caring discussion, so that the party represents all of our values. I will never vote to price people out of democracy, and I will never disincentivize members from joining trade unions. I will always ensure that the most number of voices are heard within our Labour Party, because why would I vote? The Labour Party is about representing the voices of everyone in this square, everyone in this city, and everyone in this country. We have a duty, our parliamentary Labour Party has a duty. We as a party will create something amazing. We will ensure that my members don't just get superficial short-term change. They get a leader of a Labour Party who will fundamentally change our society as we know it. I know we will if we elect Jeremy Corbyn. Thank you so much for having me today.
Thanks, Ria, and for all Labour Party members from the NEC. Okay, you've heard a lot over the last couple of weeks or so about the Parliamentary Labour Party not having confidence in Jeremy Corbyn, and 172 of them refused to support him in a motion of no confidence. Shame on them. But not all of them, let me tell you, not all MPs refuse to support Jeremy. There are a core number of supporters and MPs who supported him. I'm going to bring up onto the fire engine one of those right now. He's been a loyal supporter. He's been Jeremy's PPS since he was elected. It's the Walter MP. It's Steve Romer.
Thanks very much. It's a fantastic day out despite the rain. And for those of you who aren't from the People's Republic, welcome to a real Labour heartland. A city region where every single council is Labour controlled, and where I'm hoping to be the first ever Metro Mayor, Labour Metro Mayor in 2017. It'll probably come as a shock to many of you to discover that not every word that's actually said here will be true and accurately reported. So, for the avoidance of any doubt, I wanted to briefly explain why I'm supporting Jeremy, when many of you know that I didn't vote for him in the leadership contest last year. 12 months ago, I not only backed Andy Burnham, but did everything I could to get him elected as the leader of the Labour Party. In fact, Jeremy had a rally just in the Adelphi, just up there, and whilst we were addressing a few hundred people in the other end of the country, we were getting reports that the queue went right the way round the block, and there wasn't even standing room in the hotel. It should be noted that the Adelphi had their best ever bar takings that night. So it appears that some of you enjoyed yourselves. But during that campaign, we soon realised that members had had enough of Westminster spin. They wanted a different type of politics. They'd had enough of sound bites and triangulation. And the truth is that when the result was announced on Saturday the 12th of September 2015, we got whacked, and Jeremy received an overwhelming mandate from the membership. At that stage, we could have took our ball home and took no part in it, but we didn't. And the reason that we didn't is simple. It's because the Labour Party is the most important and vital part of our movement, bigger than any individual, and the will of the membership must be listened to. Members are the lifeblood of our party, and of course we need to listen to the wider concerns of people throughout the country suffering under Tory austerity. Critics say that those that support Jeremy must be happy to be in perpetual opposition. So let me be absolutely clear, I'm not happy to be in opposition. I don't want to simply be in a protest party. I desperately want to see a Jeremy Corbyn-led Labour government. And of course, I accept that we need to connect with all levels within the party. We all know that divided parties don't win elections. So let's ensure that this contest ends division and heralds a new unity of purpose. Well, feeling isolated within our party isn't a new phenomenon. I've been there myself. Being there when I believed as a party member I wasn't being listened to. Being there when nationally we were pushing through changes that I fundamentally disagreed with. But I didn't walk away. I was a councillor in 2002, and there were times when I thought the national leadership at that time took our efforts for granted. We became voting fodder, sometimes for things that we were principally opposed to. It's a time when I truly understood what the democratic deficit really meant. Look, it's never easy for our party sometimes in regards to the responsibilities for the great social advances that we've made over the last 100 years. On this very plateau over the weekend, rebels took part in Liverpool Pride, which saw thousands celebrate diversity with the LGBT community. Festivities are always twinned with the realisation that just a few years ago we celebrated our turn as European Capital of Culture in 2018. Young Michael Corzine was murdered on the streets simply because of his sexuality. So we should never forget that the Labour Prime Minister 49 years ago that decriminalised homosexuality, and we should remember the proud history of our party as a force for good. Intolerance in any form is anathema to our movement. Bigotry and prejudice have no part in our democratic movement, and as soon as possible, we should refocus on who it is that we really should be fighting. The Tories may try to steal our rhetoric, but they've a very different set of priorities, principles, and values. And I know that a single person here will be fooled by the new Prime Minister's phony road to Damascus transformation. When she spoke about social justice, I nearly cried. The Tories can't even spell social justice. We are the true party of the workers. We are the true party of the makers. And we always have been and always will be the only party of social justice. I was sitting behind Jeremy in the chamber when Theresa May channeled her inner Thatcher during PMQs. Do you remember when she stooped forward, looked Jeremy in the eyes, lowered the tone of her voice, and uttered the words, "Remind him of anybody?" My blood ran cold. I wanted to scream. Yes, it reminds me of the woman who decimated communities up and down the country. The woman who tried to destroy our city. And the woman who said there's no such thing as society. We can't allow Theresa May to do the same as her heroine did. If we didn't have a Labour Party, we'd have to invent one. The Tory cuts to the poorest areas, hitting the weak and most vulnerable hardest, and ideological, make no mistake about that. I'm from the city region that's being hit the hardest by the sacked George Osborne. Oh, I'm a socialist. A socialist, we can say that now. I'm a socialist. I never thought I'd celebrate someone who losing their job. But on this occasion, you'll have to forgive me for indulging in a large portion of schadenfreude. The thing is though, Gideon won't be sent on a job search programme or have to attend an ATOS assessment. His mates in the city will look after him, along with allies like IDS and Michael Gove. He was one of the architects of the attacks on our workers. As a party, we should therefore concentrate on what's really important to most people. And it's not internecine arguments that allow the Tories off the hook to inflict further damage on areas like ours. The last time we had a woman Prime Minister, our city suffered more than any other area in the country. But to be honest, the last time we had a male Tory Prime Minister, our area also suffered the more than any other area in the country. It's not about who leads their party, it's the party they lead. It's still the party of privilege, it's still the party of the bosses, and despite their attempts at detoxification, they're still very much the nasty party. They can try to rebrand themselves as much as they like, but we know what the real face of the Tories is. In the 80s, a Tory cabinet sat around the big green table in Downing Street, contemplating whether to discuss the managed decline of Liverpool. But they didn't destroy us then, and they won't destroy us today or tomorrow. We are a city of solidarity. A city of fraternity and sorority. A city of truth and justice. And I've had nothing but support from Jeremy Corbyn from day one in the campaigns that I've fought for. Whether it's the Shrewsbury pickets, contaminated blood scandal, victims of mesothelioma and asbestosis-related diseases, the exploitation of women by umbrella companies, the blacklisting of construction workers, I could go on, but he's always backed me. And I've worked with Jeremy more closely than probably any other MP in Parliament over the last 10 months. To do that, we had to build a bond of trust. I've got to know him and his family, and he's got to know mine. That bond is as strong today as it was when we first started together. I've found Jeremy to be one of the most honest, hard-working, energetic, dedicated, inclusive politicians I've ever had the pleasure of working with, both at a local and national level. He might not always button up a shirt or pull his tie straight, and believe me, I've tried. But he's a person of absolute integrity, someone with a vision for a fairer, more equal, more socially just society, a leader who has the determination to take our country forward, to tackle the exploitative practices that have disadvantaged ordinary working class people, a leader with the strength and purpose to say that we should take the railways back into public ownership, that we should ban zero-hours contracts, that we should have that controls. £45,000 isn't an affordable home, and that we should have a proper living wage of £8.25. I don't believe that the things within our party, even with the huge surge in membership, have changed things so dramatically that the result of this leadership election will provide an outcome that will differ from the last one. So, at the end of this contest, we need to get behind Jeremy so that our party provides the effective, focused opposition needed to expose Tory lies and deceit. That's why I'm supporting Jeremy Corbyn, and that's why I believe he'll remain the leader of the Labour Party.
To look at the strength of communities and what they achieve. The first time I ever spoke here in Liverpool was in the 1980s, during the miners' strike. There were rallies here in St George's Hall. That I was here with the Dockers during the heroic struggle they put forward. And I want to pay a huge tribute to all those that braved the abuse, the nastiness, and the horror of what the Murdoch press can do to stand up for the Hillsborough families. My good friend Steve Rotherham is one of your MPs and the work he did in supporting the Hillsborough families. Liverpool is a city of culture in every way. It's given so much music to the world, given so much hope to the world. But my favourite is actually Liverpool poets and the great man Roger McGough. Can I give you a quote from Roger McGough? Is that all right? Roger wrote, "Every day I think about dying, about disease, starvation, violence, terrorism, war, the end of the world. It helps to keep my mind off things." That brilliant wit is what this city is all about. But it's also about determination to live in a different world, a better society, where the poor are not consigned to the gutter and forgotten, but everyone is included and cared for. Today, we've just heard there's yet more job losses at Camel Heads, despite them getting a very big order, laying off another 98. Tonight, we send our support to the GMB Union, doing their best to defend those jobs. But we also look at all the other struggles, many of which we've won. I see over there the campaign for the blacklisted workers. Denied the possibility of working for decades by a secret cabal of employers saying they were dangerous trade unionists. Well, things have changed. We won that campaign. We won it not because of the support of the national media, but the support of ordinary people who stood up for those who speak up to defend them. Talked about the Hillsborough campaign. He's absolutely right about that. But there's some other unfinished business. We need a proper open public inquiry into what happened in Aubrey. Into what happened in the Shrewsbury pickets as well. There are a lot of issues that we need to deal with. But this week, this past couple of weeks in Tory Britain, life hasn't been easy for a lot of people. Philip Green, minister in the Tory government, living in tax exile in Monaco, retreating to his yacht, having not paid the taxes on his company, having denuded its pension fund of the resources it needs, having driven a lot of people into a situation of being unemployed and closing all those stores. What is it about Tory Britain? What is it about the Tory government? They won't intervene to defend those jobs, but instead defend the tax evaders and the tax avoiders. Then you look at Lloyds Bank, profits gone up 101% in 1 year to over 2.5 billion. Most companies that make those levels of profits, those great profits are made on the backs of those who work. Normally they'd say, well, we'll give a bit of funds to somebody in response. No, what
their response to lay off hundreds if not thousands of their workers and close their branches. Tory Spring is what it's about when the profits go up and the jobs are lost as a result of it. It should be the other way around. And a great supporter of this campaign and a great friend to all of us. Pointed out in an intervention on a speech John McDonnell was making in Parliament about Shirebrook. Dennis worked there as a miner in the 1970s. It was then pay, decent pay. We went to full union membership. There was a community around the pit. There was a strength, there was a confidence about that community. Thatcher came along, the Tories came along. They were frightened of the power of the union. They were frightened of the power of industrial workers. So not caring a thing about the energy needs of this country, instead destroyed the mining industry as an act of political vandalism, as in the same. That site, what has then happened to Shirebrook? It's now a 0 hours contract company, undercutting wages, an aggregate of minimum wage that doesn't even add up to a weekly minimum wage, ambulances called, fire tenders called, in order to deal with the health and safety conditions and dangers in that factory. What is it about deregulated, high profit, unequal Tory Britain that we tolerate that kind of thing? No, no, and no. We are going to change that. So we're not going to allow them to blame the grossly exploited workers, be they people that live down the road or migrant workers that have made their homes. We bring unity of all workers against companies like that and what they're doing. We propose something very different. Workplace 2020, a policy we're developing, which will require companies with more than 250 employees to negotiate with representative trade unions on wages and conditions. It's not right. Access to justice should not be based on the company pay. And we will also deal with the scandal of the way in which legal aid has been denied to so many within our society. So many people, they can't get justice, they can't get access to legal aid. And agents and workers, whoever they are, whatever they're doing, deserve the same rights as everybody else in work. We have this culture of exploitation and ignorance. So we do a lot more. We want to do a lot more on employment rights and justice within our society. Because that is the basis of the inequality that exists all across modern Britain. Inequality of health. One of the worst issues facing this country. In this city, the life expectancy is the biggest gap between the richest and poorest areas of this city of any city in Britain. It's 10 years. They live in the poorer area, we live 10 years less than living in the rich area. The overall average of this city is 4 years less than the national average. Is that because doctors in Liverpool don't work as hard as those elsewhere? Is it because aren't as good as elsewhere? No and no. It's all about poverty. It's all about bad housing. It's all about inequality. Those are the issues.
And the mental health crisis
that's facing this country has to be addressed. One in four of us in our lifetime are going to go through a period of deep stress, mental health conditions. Some of us will get through it with the love and support and affection of our friends and our family and our immediate network of workmates and others. Others won't. Others will be frightened to talk about it. Others will not be able to get any help. And sadly, some take their own lives as a result of that. We can do two things. One is change the mood music on how we deal with the issue of mental health. We change our support. Don't come in. The Health and Social Care Act is a conveyor belt of privatisation within the National Health Service. Requiring 59% of all services put out to private contract. Not right, not necessary, and designed to reduce our great, wonderful National Health Service free at the point of use as a human right to a health service of last resort for those who can't afford. So we stand to properly fund our National Health Service. It was founded by brave people. It was founded by a Health Minister in Ireland, Bevan, with vision. A vision of the idea that you were treated because you were ill, not because of the size of your wallet. Social care, so you don't end up with an email war between local government and the NHS about who will not treat somebody. Instead, you have a seamless system that treats everybody, again, irrespective of their wallets. The inequality in Britain comes in so many other areas as well. Too many children have been brought up in grossly overcrowded, badly maintained, expensive, damp, short-term, private rented accommodation across this country. 100 years ago, Keir Hardie, as the then leader of the Labour Party, campaigned against landlordism and what went with it. He wanted a world where there was security of tenure through council housing. He wanted regulation of the private rented sector. He wanted secure housing for all. Labour councils and Labour governments built a large number of council properties, gave people that security. It was the Tories under Thatcher that started the destruction of council housing and instead replacing it with a free market dogma. I tell you this, I want a Labour government that says our priority is to ensure by the end of that first term of that government, everyone is decently, securely, properly housed within our society. And I say to those that say this is all very expensive and very extreme, I give them two answers. Firstly, is anyone really very comfortable, however well off they might be themselves, to walk home of an evening, walking past homeless people begging on the streets? Or do they think there's something badly wrong with the society that is incapable of housing people and then forcing them to end up sleeping on the streets? And I also say that investment in secure housing, council housing, secure places for people to live, local authorities that do promote mortgages for first-time buyers, does help to solve the housing crisis, but it also creates a lot of very good jobs in the building industry and the supply chain as well. You can invest in dealing with the social problems of our society, and you can solve all of our problems at the same time. Unequal Britain devastates so many people and so many lives. Today is a sad day. It's finally the day in which the Tory government has achieved what it always wanted to. It's ended maintenance grants for students in university education. I tell you, those places that my generation enjoyed, gave many the chance to go to university, from families that had never dreamt of their son or daughter going to university. And instead, it's been replaced by fee rise after fee rise, making university education impossibly expensive and debt levels frighteningly high. Why do we allow students to leave university with debts of over £50,000 a year? Other countries don't do it that way. They instead see education as something that's a good for all of us. If any one of you goes to college and becomes a good engineer, well done, you become a good engineer. Well done, all of us, we've helped you become a good engineer. We all benefit with a safer train, a safer car, a safer plane, a safer building. We all benefit from everyone's education. So can we stop treating education as a commodity and start treating it as a right everyone should have for the benefit of everyone else? A society where we don't just educate and try to ensure they have somewhere safe to live, but also a society where we unlock the cultural potential that's there in all of us. I mentioned at the start of my speech the great Roger McGough and the Liverpool poets. There's a poet in all of us, there's a musician in all of us, there's an author in all of us. All our children need to have their hopes, their imagination unlocked. Wage levels as a proportion of national income falling, profits rising, executive pay rising, dividends rising. Should we do something a bit different? And so, after the change in leadership of our party last year, John McDonnell announced a different economic strategy. And he called it out for what it is. Austerity is a political choice, not an economic necessity. Made on the backs of cuts all over the country, made on the backs of growing inequality and growing poverty for many people. Things can be different. But it's up to our party to do things differently as well. A year ago, I'm sad to say, our party was abstaining on the welfare reform. No more are they going to go down that road. No more. Why is it that so much capital investment never leaves London or the South East, doesn't get to Merseyside, doesn't get to the North East, doesn't get to the North West? We need that investment in infrastructure, that investment that brings about the new industries, the high-tech industries, the green energy jobs, that brings about a better, more sustainable economy. It's a matter of your philosophy. Do we believe that competition is everything, or do we believe it's the role of society to invest for the good of all, not the benefit of the few? And so, when we raise all these issues, we get attacked. And we've done some analysis, and indeed independent academic analysis has been done. One newspaper, I'll leave you to guess which one it is, 84% of its stories about the Labour Party over the past year have been negative. 16% have been broadly neutral, or some would say informative. Not one story at any time in the hundreds they've printed over the past year has anything positive to say about our party. The same applies to most of the rest of the national media. Our party has been monstered by many of the journalists who should know better, and news media has been, broadcast news media, has been shamelessly biased against what the Labour Party and Labour leaders and Labour Party.
Social media, which is so important as a way of bypassing the monopoly of the Murdoch media. But we also reach out to each other in our communities, because in our own way, we're all leaders in our own communities. We can all help that thinking, that thought process, that idea of how society can, should and must be run very, very differently. And those that say this has been unpopular and no effect, if that's the case, how come there are now 540,000 people in Britain who are members of the Labour Party? How come that in only 48 hours, 183,000 people registered to vote in this leadership election? I'd like to tell you this, more than the entire membership of the Tory party in the whole of the UK. So when we're here in September for the Labour Party conference, let's make sure this is a conference about a confident, strong Labour Party and Labour movement, a confident and strong popular opinion that will sweep away the inequalities, the injustice, the nastiness of the free market society that only the Tories understand. That will be about unlocking that hope and that potential that's there in all of us. Our changes didn't come about by accident. We won the right to vote in the 19th century by the bravery of the Chartists. Women got the right to vote from the bravery of the suffragettes. We got the welfare state on the backs of all those that suffered the indignities of the means test and the vile injustices of the 1930s. That generation came together to produce something better. And ever since the late 1970s, there's been a new economic philosophy abroad. In many parts of the world, the idea that you roll back the role of the public in provisions of housing, health, education, employment, industry, research, all those things, and you leave it all to the free market. It was tried in Chile, it was tried all over Latin America, it's been done in many other parts of the world, and it was done in the USA by Reagan, and it was done in Britain by Margaret Thatcher. The big movements that are now taking place across many parts of the world are about a form of politics that challenges the way in which global corporations try to dictate to us, and instead stands up for the right of democracy to decide to ensure that all our children get decency and hope within our society. And I tell you this, in our challenges to this government, in Parliament side, we've won quite a few things. In fact, you would have read this in most of the papers, this Tory government has been defeated 22 times in the past year alone. When they came to try to take away personal independence payments for those with disabilities, the anger was so huge across the whole country, they were forced to withdraw it. But that is what they want to do, to return those with disabilities to the dignity of total dependence rather than the hope of independence that can be given by a society that cares. So it is about how we approach these things that's so important. It's the philosophy of what our movement is about. When we're humble, when we learn from the inspiration of others, when we learn from the struggles of others, from what they've achieved, we realise how strong we are together. I want our party
and say to those people struggling in poverty, those children growing up in poor quality housing, those who are better off but nevertheless want to live in a more decent, more equal society, and those that recognise we have to deal with the environmental issues facing this planet in a sensible, serious and connected way. Our socialist ideas can deal with, and will deal with all of those issues. So I don't see this leadership contest as a distraction. I see it as a massive opportunity to reach out. Reach out to people all across the country. And have the strength and confidence for those who tell us nothing you're trying to do is possible. All you have to do is compromise with the Tory philosophy and the free market ideas, and all will be well. Well, I tell you what, our determination is to achieve a society that works for all, not just a few. Our determination is to unlock our potential. But above all, our determination is to change the language of the way in which young people are spoken to. I'm fed up with being told that the current generation of pensioners have got the best they've ever got. It doesn't feel like that if you're isolated and poor and elderly in modern Britain. And I'm fed up with young people being told, sorry, you can't have the advantages your parents' generation had, because we can no longer afford the university education, the college education, the good quality apprenticeships, and all the things that you need. And by the way, the generation that comes after you will get even less than you. And I ask myself this question: this planet is incalculably wealthier than it was 20 years ago, 40 years ago, 80 years ago, 100 years ago. Technology has moved on at an amazing pace. Can't we use that technology, that brilliance, that science, that engineering, and all those things to share wealth rather than of the attacks on industrial workers in the 80s. We're strengthened by that. We're strengthened by our resolve. We're strengthened by our determination. We're above all strengthened by our collective hope. Coming together, working together, not blaming each other or blaming minorities. That gives us hope. That gives us opportunity. That gives us a world of justice, peace and human rights. Thank you.
Good. You're right. You're okay.
Comrades,
Everyone wave, everybody wave.
Comrades, you've closed Main Street. The police need to close it down.
Very well done. You've got people on Facebook. There's a young lady. There's a young lady.
Be really glad because you're part of the movement. I need to thank a couple of people who managed to turn this round in a couple of days. I want to thank the staff members in Georgia as well, who've been amazingly supportive, and thank you. I want to thank Martin Cummins and Liam Rowe, who've worked incredibly over the last couple of days to book this out. All the momentum team, my councillor colleagues, Councillor Kushner, Joanne Kushner, Councillor Anna Moffitt, and Councillor Alice Bennett. I've got Barry Kushner, we've got Councillor Alan Walker, we've got Councillor Bill Jones, we've got Councillor Jeremy Wright. There's no others. We're going to keep fighting. Thank you for coming tonight. The Main Chamber.
Real, isn't it? 7,000. Still live, Keel.
Thank you.
Yes, thanks for coming along tonight. But also, we're going to have to work very hard together to get the resources necessary for the city to deal with the quality of health and the fantastic spirit.
Oh, he won't respond.
Thank you for restoring my faith in politics and that my mother and father gave me. Thank you, Jeremy.
No one's ever talked about me.
Have you got a pen?
Yeah.
Someone had a sharpie then. Someone had a, you need a sharpie.
Oh, we've got them.
They won't do an ordinary pen, you need like a sharpie or something like that.
In our area, we don't. We've lost them.
Hello, carbonisters. When they insist he's just not good enough, well, we know better. Just look them in the eyes and say, we're voting for him anyway.
Just keep going. Stand
straight. Hold on. Jeremy.
Sorry, it didn't take.
Just sound like there. And then, just that.
Jeremy,
it didn't take. Young girl wants to.
On the back. Your phone, yeah, sure.
Do I have to pay
£25
for that as well?
No, you pay
£25. All right, then.
Steve, is this your pen?
Yeah, I'll give us the pen.
I thought we got it. Good luck with your exams. Study hard and do well.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank Something to you, sorry about that.
It's okay. Give it a sign. Come on, Jeremy.
This is Jeremy. I've spent 5 hours.
This is a smile, Steve.
I'm up to the bathroom.
This is a smile.
Okay, thanks, Jeremy.
I'll send you something.
You're speaking over down there first, so you'll have to wait.
I've sent some pictures over to you as well, your email.
Sure.
Thanks.